Hello everyone. Last time we have covered pharmaceutical aids, in that study of 14 crude drugs. As I have given you idea that in first theory sessional, along with the few general topics, you will have total 24 crude drugs. So 14 we have covered, 10 we are going to cover later on. Now today in health education subject, the third chapter, as I gave you idea that total 3 chapters are there in first theory sessional, in that concept of health first chapter, then second nutrition and health are covered. Third chapter today we will see in this, that is non-communicable diseases. Now this is the small chapter, and in 2 lectures we will try to finish up. In this we will see definition first, and as the word indicates, non-communicable means what? Ki it cannot be communicated. Now communicable diseases also one chapter we will cover later on, but that is lengthy chapter, and later on we will cover that. Now the non-communicable diseases definition is that these are the diseases which are not transmitted directly or indirectly from one person to another, but it is caused due to multiple causes. This is the appropriate definition. And one more definition in another words, as it is displayed on your screen, that non-communicable diseases, these are caused due to multiple causes. They are not passed or transmitted directly or indirectly from one person to another or by any agent. For example, cancer. Now, same thing in sentence form, you have this definition that non-communicable diseases is a disease caused due to multiple causes and are not passed or transmitted directly or indirectly from one person to another by any agent. So here you have to understand that non-communicable diseases, 4 important are there in your syllabus that we will cover. So they are not infections. Communicable diseases, we can say that they are infection, and communicable disease will have the definition opposite to non-communicable disease. So that will be transmitted from one person to another. It will spread from one person to another directly or indirectly. So that we will study later on. Just you have to understand that non-communicable diseases, they are not transmitted. They are not infections. But still nowadays many people, they are suffering from non-communicable diseases now, and they are more common in developed countries also, isn't it? Like cancer, diabetes, cardiovascular diseases, blindness, obesity, so many accidents are happening nowadays. Many degenerative disorders are also there of the body. So we will not go in detail, just for your information I have given you examples. Now what we have to discuss here in this chapter, definition we have covered, then in, as I said, 4 diseases are there in your syllabus, that is the cancer, diabetes, blindness and cardiovascular diseases. These 4 are there in your syllabus. Now in individual disease we must know that what are the risk factors. So causative agent means what? The factors which are responsible for the disease. Then symptoms, if any, isn't it? So factors or predisposing factors or risk factor, it is one and the same. Question may be asked by the name factors or risk factors or predisposing factors, that is the causes. And then we must know the types also, if any, and then prevention, care and control. So individual disease now we will cover. Now before that, the general risk factors we will cover. Now as I said that these diseases, they are common in developed countries also. In foreign countries also, the chances of infections are less, but these type of diseases, they are very common. They are not getting controlled. Why? Because the causes are social, cultural, psychological, mental or environmental. Nowadays, due to fast urbanization, industrialization, there is stress and strain in the life of people. They have got tension, isn't it? And also, the cause of these type of diseases may be in our habits also, lifestyle habits. What is lifestyle? We have discussed in the concept of health, in that factors affecting health, individual factors, lifestyle and heredity. So these type of diseases, heredity may be there, or lifestyle habits may be responsible, isn't it? And therefore, it is very difficult to control these type of diseases. But if we change our habits, if we change our routine, isn't it? So at certain level, these diseases can be controlled. Now, risk factors or predisposing factors or simply factors which are responsible for these type of diseases. So here, high blood pressure, isn't it? Then use of tobacco, smoking or chewing of tobacco, drinking of alcohol, physical inactivity, that means lack of exercise in the daily life. Then because of customs, habits and lifestyle, so there may be increased blood glucose level, there may be increased cholesterol level, isn't it? Then person, because of lifestyle habits, may become obese, likes latthapana, stool, isn't it? So that is obesity. Obesity also can give rise to many diseases. Then decrease vegetable and fruit intake. So nowadays, young children, they are not interested in the vegetables, isn't it? They just want fast food, isn't it? Like Chinese and all that, pizza, burger. So this is not the healthy food, isn't it? And this also can give rise to non-communicable diseases. So these are important risk factors, isn't it? And then nowadays in our country, the healthcare services are also inadequate, isn't it? So because of that also, the non-communicable diseases are not properly managed, isn't it? These are general risk factors for non-communicable diseases. Now one by one disease we will see. Before that, the current status presently. Now the most of the risk factors that are responsible for these type of diseases, isn't it, that we will see now. So death and disability burden in nearly all countries regardless of economic development, isn't it? So presently the cases of high blood pressure, isn't it, 13% deaths are due to increased blood pressure, that is hypertension we can say. Then many people, those who are using tobacco in any form, smoking or chewing, so 9% deaths are because of use of tobacco. Then increased blood glucose level, so diabetes, if the person is suffering from diabetes, so that is also a risk factor for the death, that is 6%. Then lack of physical exercise, 6%, we can correlate the deaths due to lack of physical exercise. And then overweight, high body weight, obesity. So 5% case deaths may be because of obesity also. Now first disease we will cover, only 4 are there in this chapter as I said. Cancer now we will discuss. Now cancer, it is an abnormal proliferation. Proliferation means growth, we can say multiplication of cells in any organ in the body, forming mass or tumor. So the other name for cancer we can use is tumor, or we can say carcinoma or malignancy. These are the similar terms which can be used for cancer. It invades surrounding tissue and destroys them, isn't it? So you can diagrammatically see the normal cells and abnormal cells, isn't it? How the proliferation is taking place, how the multiplication is taking place. So this multiplication of cells can take place in any part of the body, in any tissue, in any organ, isn't it? And it can involve any type of body cells, isn't it? There are different types also, like oral cancer may be there due to use of tobacco. Then esophagus may be involved, esophageal cancer. Cancer of cervix and uterus in case of females. Breast cancer in case of females. Then lung cancer, isn't it? Cancer of the stomach, gallbladder, isn't it? Liver cancer, blood cancer, that is leukemia. These are the different types of cancer which can happen, isn't it? Now same thing, types as I have given you, the majority of the cancer deaths, they are because of the lungs, breast, isn't it? Colorectal, stomach, liver, isn't it? Then the other reason behind the death of the person due to cancer may be high income countries, isn't it? The leading cause of cancer deaths are lung cancer among men and breast cancer among women. Then in low and middle income countries, cancer levels vary according to prevailing underlying risk, isn't it? So this types of cancers that may vary from one country to another depending upon the income source and lifestyle habits of the people. Now risk factors for cancer, isn't it? So in cancer, as I gave you, that the multiplication takes place of the cells, which is abnormal and purposeless, isn't it? Without any purpose. And the multiplication of cells take place, the mass increases in size, isn't it? This increased mass may give trouble to the nearby organs, adjacent organs. Then normally cells may grow and they may die also, but these abnormal cells, they do not die, and the cancer or the tumor goes on increasing to such an extent that it cannot be removed successfully, and that may be the cause of death. The risk factors for cancer are tobacco and smoking, food habits, obesity, sedentary lifestyle, occupational exposure. So the occupation of a person also in some cases may be responsible for cancer. Family history, viruses, isn't it? Alcohol, socioeconomic status, pollution, ultraviolet radiations, drugs and medical procedures, isn't it? Salt, food, additives and contaminants. So in food articles, so many additives are used, color, flavor, isn't it? So these also may be the contributory factors, isn't it? Now, so many things we have seen which are responsible for cancer, they may be contributory factors, isn't it? So now, before prevention, I'll give you some signs important of cancer. So any sore that cannot heal any sore. So if any ulcer type is there, isn't it? If any wound we can call, isn't it? Internal wound or sore, isn't it? Ulcer type that does not get healed. Then there is formation of mass or lump, isn't it? Anywhere in the body. Then there may be bleeding also or discharge that may take place from that part of the body. Then there is difficulty in swallowing, and there may be indigestion also in cancer patients. There may be persistent cough, isn't it? And voice of the patient also changes, and there are certain sudden changes in skin, and there may be outgrowth also of the skin, like any outgrowth, any abnormality, abnormal growth may take place, and that may be seen from externally, isn't it? Now, prevention of cancer, preventive measures we will see. So you can see in table form, first points are primary points, then secondary, and then tertiary. So primary, we can say that these smoking and drinking of alcohol must be avoided. Then food preservatives must not be used unless necessary. Spicy foods must be avoided, mirch masale, isn't it? Spicy foods are also responsible for cancer. Then proper storage of grains and peanuts, isn't it? Then avoid hormone intake, isn't it? So hormonal preparations must be taken very cautiously, isn't it? Then the persons must be vaccinated against hepatitis, isn't it? Then early diagnosis of any disease is very important, isn't it? Control of environmental pollution, isn't it? Then breastfeeding must be encouraged in infants. As we have studied in nutrition and health, the best diet for infants is mother's milk. Then secondary prevention in cancer is early diagnosis, screening test. So screening is carried out, isn't it? Of the persons who are at high risk, isn't it? Then cervical smear can be taken. So in case there is cervical cancer, so that can be detected by collecting the cervical smear. That means the sample. In simple meaning, we can say the sample is collected from the cervix. Then sputum sample can be collected. X-ray examination can be done, isn't it? Then biopsy can be done, isn't it? Now, tertiary prevention. So in later stages, when it is very difficult to control cancer, so in that, rehabilitation of the person is very important. Psychological assurance is very important, and palliative treatment is very important. Palliative means what? We know that the disease will not get cured, isn't it? But we have to prepare the person psychologically. So that is about cancer. Then next important disease is diabetes. Now, diabetes mellitus, it is associated with the disorder of glucose metabolism, isn't it? Now, diabetes is a chronic disease, hereditary we can call, that occurs when the pancreas does not produce enough insulin. Now, insulin is a hormone that regulates our blood sugar level, and insulin is secreted from the pancreatic cells, isn't it? Now, diabetes can occur when the body is not able to use insulin. Already it is produced in the body, isn't it? Or overall, the risk of dying among people with diabetes is at least double the risk of their peers without diabetes, isn't it? So the risk factor of the person increases if they are suffering from diabetes, isn't it? Now, diabetes may be due to, as I said, inability of pancreas to produce insulin, or inability of the body cells to use insulin, isn't it? So diabetes mellitus is a condition in which there is elevated blood sugar level, isn't it? Normally, the blood sugar must be in between 80 to 120 milligram per 100 ml, isn't it? Now, if it is increased, isn't it, more than 120 or 140, so there are chances that the person is suffering from diabetes. Now, when the blood sugar is more than the normal concentration, it is called hyperglycemia also. You must know the term hyperglycemia. And when the blood sugar level is less than the normal, then it is called hypoglycemia, isn't it? Now this diabetes, that about 347 million people worldwide are suffering from diabetes, isn't it? It is an emerging global epidemic, we can say, of diabetes that can be traced back to rapid increases in overweight, that is obesity, and physical inactivity. Now here, the important factors which are responsible for diabetes are obesity, dietary factors, and hereditary. These are three important factors, isn't it? Family history, that is heredity, food habits, isn't it? As well as the alcoholic beverages, the person who has got habit of drinking alcohol also, so that increases our appetite. By increased appetite, the intake of food increases. That contributes to weight gain, isn't it? And when the body weight increases, the person suffers from obesity, and obesity is the contributory factor in diabetes, isn't it? Also, the person who has got habit of drinking alcohol, gradually the pancreatic cells get damaged, isn't it? And that also increases the risk of diabetes. Now, the incidence of diabetes is higher in persons above 40 years of age, isn't it? But it can happen in any age. Now, 80% of diabetes deaths occur in low and middle income countries, isn't it? In developed countries, most people with diabetes are above age of retirement, whereas in developing countries, those most frequently affected are aged between 35 to 64 years of age. Now, types we will see. Clinically, there are two types of diabetes, isn't it? Type 1 and type 2. Now, you have to understand the different names also. There are only two types. We can call as type 1 and type 2. Type 1 is also called juvenile onset type. Juvenile onset type is also called insulin dependent diabetes mellitus. Again, I repeat, type 1 is also called juvenile onset type. Juvenile onset type is also called insulin dependent diabetes mellitus. Now, in type 1, you will see it is written no insulin. That is why the person suffering from type 1 is insulin dependent. Whereas second is type 2 diabetes. Now, what is written? Cells do not respond to insulin. That means insulin is secreted, isn't it, in type 2. Therefore, the other name for type 2 is non-insulin dependent diabetes mellitus. And this is also called maturity onset type. Now, type 1 occurs in young age, during first 40 years of age, and it is having rapid onset. In this type, pancreas do not produce insulin, so a person has to take insulin from outside. Whereas in type 2 diabetes, that occurs in elderly age after 40 years of age, isn't it? The pancreas are producing insulin, but it is inadequate. So this type of diabetes can be controlled by dietary control alone or light exercise or along with oral hypoglycemic drugs also. Now, important symptoms you must know. What are the signs and symptoms of diabetes? So as you can see in this slide, the different symptoms, isn't it? Always hungry. That means we can write down increased appetite. Jada bhook lagna, isn't it? Then unexplained weight loss. Loss of weight is another symptom. Then numbness or tingling fingers, isn't it? Then frequent urination, isn't it? So frequent urination is there, passing large volume of urine. Then extreme fatigue, isn't it? So general weakness and fatigue is there, isn't it? Pain in the legs, isn't it? Irritability, lack of concentration, sensitivity to infection, chances of infection are more in diabetic patient, delayed wound healing, isn't it? So these are important symptoms in diabetes. Then prevention and control. Now, before prevention, you must also know that there are certain other complications of diabetes also. There are so many symptoms we have studied, but because of the poor circulation of blood in body, the diabetic patient has got more risk of heart disease, kidney failure, poor vision, isn't it? Feeling of pins and needles, loss of sensation, isn't it? So it is very important that in diabetic patient, the blood sugar must always be controlled to a normal range. If it is not controlled, then the chances of other diseases are very more. The long-term complications with diabetic patient are associated with heart disease, kidney damage, and even blindness also. Now, prevention and control. So here also at three levels we will see how diabetes is prevented. So you can write down point wise generally, or at three levels you can write down whichever you find easier. So primary prevention will include maintaining normal body weight, adopting healthy habits, taking well balanced diet, regular exercise, avoid drinking of alcohol, avoid smoking, avoid mental stress, tension in the life. Then secondary prevention in diabetes will include that the person must take care according to the medical advice given to him. So maintaining normal body blood glucose level by using insulin injection at proper time and in proper dose. Proper intake of food, that is proper diet, is very important. Use of oral drugs, isn't it? Time to time, they are very important. Taking care of the skin, feet and wounds. Proper treatment of diabetes complications, isn't it? By visiting diabetic clinics. And apart from this prevention, the person must take insulin regularly if he is suffering from type 1 diabetes, or if he is suffering from type 2 non-insulin dependent diabetes mellitus. So he can take oral drugs also, because type 2 can be controlled by use of oral hypoglycemic agents and regular exercise also. And modification in food habits also can control diabetes in persons. So these are some of the examples of oral hypoglycemic agents: sulfonylureas, chlorpheniramine, Then biguanide is the another category in oral drugs, metformin and all that, isn't it? So the type 2 diabetes can be controlled by food, diet modification, physical exercise and drugs also. So here we have finished up two important diseases, that is cancer and diabetes. Remaining two that are blindness and cardiovascular disorders, that we will cover in the next lecture. Thank you.